Indiana won the tournament in 2013, Maryland 14, 15, and 16. They square off today. Let's take a look at the starting lineup for Maryland. Donovan Pines, first team all Big Ten, is out. St. Martin is in. Your lineup brought to you by Discover, and your Discover starting lineup for Indiana. Remember, no Renix, no Dorsey there with the USA U-20s. Indiana still pretty darn good, undefeated in Big Ten play. And here we go. Chris Doran, Dean Linke, delighted to be with you for semifinal number one. Michigan and Wisconsin will play the next game. Semifinal number two. Indiana in white, Maryland in red, black, and black. Westfield, Indiana, just outside of Indianapolis, as the Indiana Hoosiers have some home cooking here in Westfield, Indiana. There's Gutman off the head of Ben. And we talked about it just real quick there. Donovan Pines got the call from Sasso Sarosky, 7 a.m. this morning. He took a shot to the head with a ball in practice and had headaches. Entered that protocol situation. You know the deal, Chris. It takes a certain amount of days to get out of it. He's not out of it till tomorrow, so he can't play.
And that's a big miss, not just in terms of presence from Donovan Pines and experience, but he's a 6'4", 6'5" defender. He always figures into a restart for Maryland, both defensively and offensively. The opportunity there for St. Martin to step in is critical.
Buckmaster out of bounds off of Indiana and come back to Maryland. Dane St. Clair, the Canadian, wearing number 99. Waited for Mr. Niedermeyer to graduate and slipped right in there. Does have a year of eligibility left, has not made a final determination on whether he'll come back next year. Decided to celebrate senior day with the class he came in with.
Of course, when we talk about deciding to come back, he's contemplating, in all likelihood, a professional career. I think Dane St. Clair would benefit from probably another year of training at the college level and competing as well.
Andrew Gutman, the decision to come back for him certainly has worked out. He will indeed be in St. Louis as one of the three finalists for the Mack Herman Trophy. He's had that kind of impact from his left back position. Reese Buckmaster has also had himself a really nice season. Timmy Mell and Jack Mayer solidify that back line. Frankie Moore, the captain, holding midfielder, really the heart and soul of the team. What a season for Indiana. No team has ever gone 8-0 since nine teams have come in to Big Ten men's soccer, and then able to hold off a Northwestern team. Got to give Tim Lenihan's team a whole lot of credit for fighting till the end in Bloomington, but of course Indiana advancing thanks to Spencer Glass. But I mean, Indiana, unbelievable, 9-0 in Big Ten play this year.
Yeah, it's their first title in 8 years, 15th overall. But it's interesting that in all the success they've had, not just under Todd Yeagley, but with Coach Freitag, the 2003-2004 run, it's been a long time since they've been able to celebrate that regular season championship, a really big mile marker for this group that came into the season knowing that they were finalists last year and lost to a very good Stanford team, but you know, maybe didn't have their best performances in spots during that national championship game. You kind of feel like they're playing with a vengeance to get back to that College Cup final.
Indeed. Gutman. Gutyar. Palazzolo. Griffin Dorsey, no Justin Renix, who are, by the way, not only with the U.S. under-20 team, but making their mark, being productive, scoring goals for Tab Ramos and the USA. And Todd Yeagley also saying that communication between his coaching staff, as you see Todd Yeagley right there, incredible record, ninth season, of course, played for his dad, the godfather, Jerry Yeagley, and was the former college player of the year. And it's been good communication with Tab Ramos, though, about Dorsey and Renix, for sure.
Yeah, at first it was about, hey, here's what we're thinking. What does your schedule permit? These guys are really important to us. And then it's, how long are they going to be away?
Gutyar into space. Gutman hit with his left foot. Did not appear to be on the frame. Frankie Moore will stay with it.
You see how compact Maryland is playing this first half defensively. They've got the news that Pines is out. They've got a fresh face in the back. They're working with the DeRosas on the flanks.
There's Sadich, one of the impact players chosen by Chris Doran. Marsadich coming up strong here late in the season. Elney, and this will come right to Trey Muse as we talked about Sadich being unselfish.
Yeah, unselfish, and what I meant by that in the pregame was that I'd like to see him shoot a little more instead of dishing this outside where Elney's going away all day long with only one target across the front of the box. Why not go ahead and figure out a way to cut that ball back and load it up?
Chris Doran, as always, in championship form. I agree 100% because Sadich, the great thing about him is he can hit it right foot or left foot. So you're right, cut it back and have a rip at it. Sebastian Elney had some big moments in his career. Not as many this year, his senior campaign, as he would like. Health has been an issue. Talking about some rain and snow, all things considered, it's cold. It is cold, but these are not the worst conditions we've seen at Grand Park.
No, they certainly aren't. I can tell you that the Wisconsin group is probably relishing this chilly weather. The breeze is mild at best going across the field, and the surface is in terrific condition.
That Wisconsin group coming up next against the Michigan Wolverines. John Trask, what a job he's done trying to make it three straight Big Ten tournament finals. How about this whistle?
Yeah, just a little pregame contact. You know, I don't think you expect these two teams to really be very chippy with one another. They both like the ball on the ground. They both like to move it quickly. To the extent to which we start to see restarts in dangerous situations, I think it's primarily going to be, and this is Reese Buckmaster playing through the ball and the opponent as well, I think we're probably going to see a little more opportunity in terms of shooting restarts, dangerous restarts for Indiana in the attacking third, simply because of the makeup of what Maryland's dealing with right now. With the absence of Donovan Pines and maybe just the drive to be cohesive back there as Maryland looks to put their mark on this game.
Paul Bin, pass was too long. There's Sasso Sarosky, 26 seasons. Won a national championship in 2005, 2008. Incredible run to start his time in the Big Ten. Won the three first Big Ten tournaments that Maryland played in, 14, 15, and 16. And I can tell you he's determined to get his team back there. It's not going to be easy, though, without Donovan Pines and Chase Gasper, questionable to even play. He did have a sense of humor, though. When he called me this morning, he figured, you know what, with Dorsey and Renix out, we're just trying to level the playing field. And then, of course, he chuckled knowing he was just kidding because those are key players out for Indiana. But any way you look at it, Donovan Pines is 6'5", almost 6'6". He's a force in the back and a big loss.
Yeah, we have been impressed over the course of Pines' career about how well he plays defensively in 1v1 situations in the open field and certainly under duress when, you know, Maryland is looking to hold the lead late or they're looking to retain a lead late. He's been terrific for Maryland.
Here's Gutman coming forward to knock it away. Gutman has the kind of free reign that a traditional number 10 at the highest level would have, and he's a left back.
Yeah, when he sneaks in there, he messes things up. Teams get comfortable with their marks and with the numbers and the matchups, and then all of a sudden Gutman makes that diagonal run up the middle. Knowing just how dangerous he is, he's a guy who's had a great career, Tim Mell, for Indiana. He's got a goal and an assist. Been a part of over 40 shutouts in his 3 years as a starter here with Indiana.
Andrew Samuels, happy to be back in that holding mid position. He had to play a lot of right back this year. Let's talk about both coaches. Todd Yeagley, in my opinion, one of the most phenomenal jobs coaching I've ever seen. I mean, they've not lost a single game in the Big Ten. He has been able to juggle 7 to 8 midfielders, move his defenders around depending on what he sees, changed his number 9 at times. Of course, he's given the reins to Gutman as well. And here comes Thomas into the 18. Thomas with the shot. St. Clair with the save. And right there falling. Gutman was there. So was Swartz. Deflected off of Indiana, though, and out of bounds.
Corey Thomas does a nice job of deciding to take a rip. He forces Dane St. Clair to make the save. That second layer of attack is your left back. Andrew Goodman moving in up top. He had the opportunity. And Austin Poncho in there as well. Maryland does well to keep Indiana off the scoreboard.
Dane St. Clair has made some big saves in his time between the pipes for the Maryland Terrapins. Reese Buckmaster with the throw. But talking about Todd Yeagley, I feel like all of that coaching has prepared his team for the inevitable, losing Renix and Dorsey for U20 qualifications. Gutgar's had a ton of experience. Poncho, who just had that shot, has had a ton of experience. Swartz can play anywhere. And then the emergence of Palazzolo up top as well means with Spencer Glass coming off the bench, it's still a pretty complete team despite missing those superstars.
Dean, this squad went to the College Cup final and they lost by a goal to Stanford, the three-time champion. These guys have got more than just playing time experience in the regular season. They know what it takes to get to that last game on the schedule. And so what they bring in the way of understanding how to be under duress and how to manage a game, all of those intangibles are things that, you know, you can only deliver to a player in their development if you put them in that situation. And they were put in that situation last year.
Sadich, right side here to Ben. Elney's going to peel off. Ben looking for Elney. Elney stays with it. Down on the ground is Mel. And now Goodman drop it to Poncho. Swartz has it ripped away. Ben can't find Sadich.
Corey Thomas gets tied up, foul called, and here's Paul Ben. He's great at driving that ball in from the outside. He's been terrific so far. Elney not able to get a first touch on it. Good defending from Tim Mell as he closes down Elney in that opportunity. Indiana dodging a Maryland attack.
Jack Mayer, as you think about impact players, he's the Big Ten Freshman of the Year. Grant Lillard departs, and in steps Jack Mayer, and he's the best freshman in the league. That will work if you're swapping center backs out. Lillard was so outstanding, left as the Big Ten Defender of the Year. As you see Cronally down, and in steps the Big Ten Freshman of the Year. Speaking of former Defenders of the Year, his brother Alex for Maryland was a former Big Ten Defender of the Year. As you see the collision there between Mel and Cronally.
Cronally is a very technical player, loves to have the ball at his feet. If he collects that ball and is able to find someone with whom to connect, Tim Mel knows there could be damage in the back. Mel comes in pretty strong, draws the foul. I beg your pardon, it's not a foul, it's actually going to be a drop ball. Good game management from Kalen Rodazov, who is our referee this afternoon, seeing that Cronally was down.
See the fans all bundled up on a chilly Friday afternoon, semifinal Friday on BTN. Favorite part of the year, you break down the temperature, 36 degrees, wind at 13. Chris, last weekend for the women's Big Ten soccer tournament, won by Stephanie Golan and the Minnesota Golden Gophers in penalty kicks over Penn State. The wind was up near 20 miles per hour, and even bursts that were as high as 25 miles per hour during that. They'll take that at around 13 miles per hour. That won't be so bad.
The northern, one of the northern suburbs of Indianapolis, Westfield, is an area that's being developed, but it is still primarily agriculture. It is still primarily farmland, and so plenty of flat land for the breeze to pick up speed as it coasts across this northern part of Indianapolis.
Mayer playing forward to Palazzolo. A.J. Palazzolo, he was in the running for that center back position. Knowing that they were bringing in a freshman, Mayer solidified the spot early, so Palazzolo said, hey, I can also play center forward. He scored the goal early in the season to knock off the North Carolina Tar Heels, and he has been a regular ever since.
Gutyard doesn't see Samuels coming in as he's getting ready to poke to Swartz, and Samuels gets whistled for the foul on Gutyard.
Gar has shown his versatility this year as Frankie Moore worked his way into full game fitness after a successful internship in the summertime. Gar has slid back at times, even started at that number six. As you coach Jeremy Gutyar as a youngster, you've got to be impressed with his development during his time with the Indiana Hoosiers.
Well, I spent very little time with Jeremiah Gutyar, but he was a phenom from a very young age, and it was identified by a lot of people in the Bloomington community who then said, you know, maybe he should go play for Phil Presser in the Indiana Fire Academy, which is housed right here at Grand Park. His development from that point forward, all credit to Coach Presser and the folks who were a part of the Indiana Fire Academy. And then you know the story that he decided in his senior year that he was probably going to be just as good, instead of making that trip from Bloomington to Indianapolis for training, entering Indiana in the spring of his senior high school year, became a freshman early, and now here he is 4 years later in his final season. This is Gutyar making that run, and this is something he wouldn't have done when he was a younger player, but he's making that really dangerous run deep into the attacking third. He's a guy who's more of a box-to-box player, works real hard on defense, and he connects with his attacking players. Very high IQ. And I have talked to some folks with Major League Soccer who have said he would be an ideal candidate at the next level.
Another one of those players that has overcome injury during his time. As you see, the fouls, four for Maryland, two for Indiana. Trevor Swartz, one of the best left feet in the country. He can absolutely put it on point. And Swartz with that left foot going near post. And St. Clair and Mel, and the whistle before it'll come back to Maryland.
Mentality of a goalkeeper is get to that ball first. Full extension, Dane St. Clair beats the contact coming in from Tim Mel and does a really nice job of punching that ball out to safety on the contact. The whistle blows.
So we know Brett St. Martin, the freshman from Mount Airy, gets the start at center back. That's his natural position. As Sasha Swarovski said, he's one of the best in the air. And so he's perfect at center back. And that means the DeRosa twins, Ben DeRosa on the right wearing 25, Matt DeRosa on the left wearing number 27, will flank that back line. And really, it's been the emergence of Matt DeRosa more as a left midfielder, almost a left forward, as you see Paul Ben, that helped Maryland climb back up the ladder after playing the most grueling schedule I've ever seen in 20 plus years of calling college soccer. Their schedule this year, just off the charts, ridiculous.
You've got a lot of ranked teams in there. The only way that they are able to, as Sasha knows, continue to keep themselves in the national conversation if they're not winning championships within their conferences to be getting positive results against ranked teams. And Sasha makes the point that there are some college teams that do not like to get on the bus or get on the plane and leave home for those big-time games. Sasha's willing to do that with the Maryland Terrapins, and that's how he gets those points in the RPI each week.
Yeah, phenomenal RPI because of it, and a lock to make yet another NCAA tournament. But just a quick look at Washington, Stanford at home, Virginia on a neutral site. As you see, the RBI 12 right now for Maryland. West Virginia, Coastal Carolina, Georgetown, Denver. Those were the non-conference games. Those are all regulars in the NCAA tournament and regulars that make an impact in the NCAA tournament.
Well, this ball sneaks through a couple of defenders. Austin Poncho, if he can turn and get to it first, has the opportunity. St. Martin does well to turn that ball outside. Whistle blown.
There is St. Martin's been playing a lot of right back of late, but slides into that right center back position with the news that Donovan Pines, first team all Big Ten defender, out because of concussion protocol. DeRosa, comma Ben, number 25. On the other side, it'll be DeRosa, comma Matt. I say they put their full name on the back. Matt DeRosa, Ben DeRosa. How proud are you of those young men as parents watching them start here? Semifinal Friday, number one, the twins on each side of that back line. There's Thomas, who burst onto the scene last year, all Big Tenner a year ago. Hasn't totally got going this year, but he's done enough to be a regular for Todd Yeagley. Samuels. Composure there from Bergman in St. Martin. Told you these two teams meeting back on October 12th in Bloomington, and a 2-1 win. 18 seconds left in the game, and Indiana knocks off Maryland, which has not been easy over the years for Indiana. Maryland has been a major thorn in the side of the Hoosiers. Even really in the Godfather days, Maryland has always given a big hard punch to Indiana.
I remember talking to Sasha Sarovsky as we watched this ball nearly sneak through, but Omar Sadich gets tangled up with Buckmaster in the whistle. I remember talking to Sasha when he came out for the Adidas Classic in the fall, had to have been back in the 90s. And he spoke so highly of Coach Yeagley, the Godfather, and his building of the Indiana program, and how proud he was to know that he was in, you know, the same profession and committed to doing the same thing at Maryland.
Think about this man here, Gutman, who scored that goal with 18 seconds remaining. When he did that, Chris, it snapped an 8-match winless streak in the series for the Hoosiers against Maryland, and it marked their first series victory over Maryland since an incredible 3-2 decision in double overtime of the semifinals of the NCAA College Cup in Carson, California, December 10th, 2004. Now, why is that significant? When we asked Todd Yeagley this week, what are the two games you remember most? That was the one he went to. And then the next year, they played in the regular season. Maryland was leading 3-0 with 18 minutes remaining in the game. Indiana scored three to tie the Terrapins. Those are his top two memories.
They're just terrific memories, and to hear Todd talk about it, you'd think it happened yesterday. Coaches have a tendency to remember games and details that the average consumer might overlook.
Well, that was big, though, for Maryland, because they would go on to win the national championship in 2005 after being so close. Gutman off the crossbar. He is everywhere, folks, and Andrew Gutman so close to making it 1-0. Thomas slides it over to Poncho, and Andrew Gutman, so close.
This is Gutyar and the magic of his vision, the way he watches for Gutman to cut through, and he cuts the defender, goes right up the middle. Three defenders split, and they leave him a swath of real estate in which to work, and he loads up that foot. You're thinking maybe right foot in that situation, but he does love the left in particular. Great stuff from Gutman in Indiana.
What a move, just to create his own space and run right onto it. Corner kick for Swartz over the head of Gutman. Loose as it fell to Poncho. Picked back up by Gutyar. Now Frankie Moore over the top to Swartz. Swartz wants it back on his left, side of his left there to Poncho. Poncho lofted ball. No white jersey there. He almost felt like Ben thought Gutman was going to be there because he's everywhere. He wasn't that time. Thomas trying to get it over the top to Poncho. There's Gutman. Takes it away from Ben. Will cross it. Tough ball, but somehow finds Buckmaster. Now Poncho, good turn. Deflected in front of St. Clair. Corner kick, Indiana.
This is a great sequence from Indiana. It's like they've found fourth gear already. A couple of opportunities, and Gutman is, as you mentioned, Dean, right in the middle of it, finds Buckmaster on this crossed ball, forces midfielders to come back to defend, and Poncho with a shot, deflected, and a corner kick opportunity. This is Trevor Swartz on that previous corner. You think Dane St. Clair's got to hang on to that ball. He really does in a semifinal situation. Opportunity now for Indiana, and Austin Poncho in the near corner.
Poncho with that great shot moments ago to draw the corner kick, and he's going to take it with his right foot. Of course, his brother, a star and captain for Stanford, driven in hard near post. And Reese Bachmaster.
Dean, I think this is one of the things about Indiana this year, maybe in particular, compared to last year. They really hurt you in a lot of different ways. And yes, they're missing Renix and they're missing Dorsey, but this Indiana squad with the talent and the experience in the body of this lineup is extraordinary in the way they can come at you in so many different ways.
And Usley's on the end of those so many different ways. Good touch from Palazzolo. It was a good touch down the middle. And you're right, Indiana clicking.
Big ball, good defense on the far side, but still an opportunity with the cross ball. And Jeremiah Gutyar, you see, again, looking in that, in the way of distribution to find Gutman.
Yep, Gutyar and Gutman again, Chris, well said. Palazzolo also with a pretty good touch. Gutman denied there by DeRozan. He'll get it right back. Pancho. Gutman. Off of DeRosa, there's Elney checking back to try to help get Maryland as they are pinned in at the moment. It's all Indiana right now.
Simple technical point, but Jack Mayer backpedaling, taking that ball down, collecting it off his chest like he's a four-year starter for Indiana. So mature back there. The freshman defender who has stepped in and, as you mentioned, filled the gap of the departed Grant Lillard, who is enjoying his pro career in Chicago.
Dane St. Clair booms it long. Second ball, though, picked up by Indiana. Thomas bring it back to Mayer. And now Thomas again. Palazzolo. Gutman fouled there by, no, they'll say Gutman fouled Ben. Fair play, Ben with the tap right there, so the foul will go against the Big Ten Defender of the Year.
I don't know, I think that may have been a late step in by Paul Bin.
Well, they may have got it right here after all.
I'm on right one.
Yeah, they have, so Indiana over the ball.
Good.
That was my reaction at first as well. It looked like they pointed the other way when the referee came over, but they got it right. Swartz is over the ball. So Palazzolo will be in there. Timmy Mell will be in there. Mayer will also come forward. And here's Trevor Swartz. Lofted ball. St. Clair had it the entire time.
That's more encouraging from St. Clair from a defensive standpoint. That ball is going away, and he's tracking it all the way outside the far post and pulling it down with his hands. You don't want to give a team like Indiana a second chance inside the 18. If your keeper can hold that ball, keep the bread in the basket. Good stuff from Dane St. Clair.
So you know about the 2-1 win this year. 13th time these two teams have gotten together, and every single time they've been decided by a single goal or less, with 8 of the last 11 matches decided in extra time, Indiana and Maryland.
So we see the first substitution as Trevor Swartz comes off and Spencer Glass comes in, number 21 for Indiana. He'll play on the left-hand side. He drives a tremendous ball in, and he works very well with Andrew Gutman.
Yeah, he's a redshirt sophomore, 6 feet, 165-pounder from Fort Wayne Carroll High School. And he's a guy last year, Chris, we've talked about it before, that God's dad, Jerry Yeagley, knew was going to be a special player. Pancho with the left foot.
Good stuff again. Build up from Indiana as Frankie Moore finds Bachmaster. Threads the needle with the pass, and Pancho with an opportunity top the 18. Good to take that. Wind is whipping around here a bit. You never know when it's going to be a benefit to you. And so Bachmaster with that overlapping run, and Pancho with the decision to go ahead and shoot ends up with a corner kick for the Hoosiers.
Corner kick again for Pancho. 17 minutes remaining here in the first. Frankie Moore back to Pancho along the end line as Lance Sade has checked into the game for Sasha Sorosky, wearing number 21. Part of a pretty good freshman class for Coach Sorosky. You see him at the bottom of your screen. There is Glass with the left foot that Chris Dorn just told you about. Gutman stays on. No, he doesn't. They'll say he left just a second too early. One of the best engines you're ever going to see, this man, number 15.
I think one of the things that Indiana is starting to pick up on is where they're going to find the gaps for that penetrating pass through the back line of Maryland's defense and toward goal. You've seen in a couple of sequences here in the last probably 5 to 7 minutes where they have identified those gaps and they're taking advantage of it.
Ronalli pushes it forward. Matsilevich, the hero against Damon Rensing's Michigan State team, which will also be a lock to be in the NCAA tournament. Solid RPI, tough schedule as always. Non-conference big-time games, including against Akron, Notre Dame, they always play a good schedule. So you know Damon Rensing's team will check the box. And that's a team that has been good in the NCAA tournament. Several Elite Eight runs. It was Indiana that knocked them out in the Elite Eight last year. A thriller in Bloomington where it took a couple days for Michigan State to even get off the field as the fans stormed the field in that NCAA tournament game. James Hervey made the All-Big Ten freshman team. Reese Buckmaster, I do love, we talk about him being underrated. Underrated no more. Second team All-Big Ten. Timmy Mel also on that second team All-Big Ten. You only give up 4 goals in the entire Big Ten play. All of them should be on there.
This defensive group in the back has been fantastic, and the incorporation of Jack Mayer, so polished and so mature as a freshman, under a bit of a test here with this corner kick from Maryland.
Eli Cronalli. Just mishit that one.
We're in a semifinal tournament game, so you got to keep in mind that, and I know we're dealing with a little bit of wind out there for Eli to drive that ball. I love the idea to drive it, but these opportunities start to become fewer and farther between, and in a restart situation, in particular a corner kick, you've got to be ready to give your team a chance.
7-1 in favor of Indiana on shots, says Trey Muse, who was in the player pool, by the way, for that U.S. under 20 team that is trying to qualify for the U-20 World Cup that'll be held in Poland in June. And Ramos had some European selections as well that he could go with, so kind enough to keep Trey Muse with Indiana. That would have been tough to not only take those two great attacking players, but a rocking goal would have been a tough pill to swallow. Here's Buckmaster. Buckmaster.
It's gone.
Good communication back there from St. Clair as that ball not able to find Spencer Glass. Indiana and Maryland, semifinal number one. John Trask, the Wisconsin Badgers, Shaka Daly, and the Michigan Wolverines coming up after this one right here on BTN for a shot in Sunday's championship game that you can see right here on the Big Ten Network.
The small group defending right now from Indiana is not allowing Maryland to get much done. You're seeing a lot of 3v2 situations where Indiana's got a numbers up, no possession situation. They force Maryland into errors and don't allow them to build out of those spaces.
Amar Sadich burst onto the scene as a freshman. Made the All Big Ten freshman team and received notice, but as you said, perhaps a little bit too unselfish over the last couple years and starting to take over late during Maryland's run. At number 12 RPI though shows that they are also a lock for the NCAA tournament. Push forward here for Indiana. Thomas War getting a run wearing that number 9 jersey. As War will get more time with Renix and Dorsey not here. War, a sophomore from Zionsville, Indiana, Zionsville High School. Lansade. Venetius Lansade. Andrew Samuels. For Hervé. Yeah, talking about the job Todd Yeagley's done and the easy choice for Big Ten Coach of the Year, it's not been easy for Sasso Sarosky. I mean, he cannot get a healthy team. They have been decimated not just by severe injuries like Gasper in his back, but by a flu and terrible like stomach issue that has circulated throughout his team and other Maryland teams. It's like nothing he's ever seen in 26 years of coaching.
Yeah, you always hate it when you get a coach on the phone and they're talking about how they're healthy from a physical standpoint in terms of injuries, but they're dealing with a bug that's going through the locker room, and that's a tough one for any coach. Those bugs hit players in different ways. And then after that, the recovery, the necessity to hydrate, and the necessity to eat well. You get a player back from something like that, but they're not at 100%. The match time that they've lost.
So both coaches working extra time here this year to get it right. Of course, Indiana perfect. Maryland, that 12 RPI, pretty impressive.
Back post.
Glass. Driven in by Spencer Glass, who seems to relish that super sub role. DeRosa, nifty behind the back, and he'll square it. Good idea, trying to find Lansade, and Lansade is fouled. Mel doesn't like the call.
Well, it's poor timing from Tim Mel. Give Maryland credit. Good numbers back defensively to snuff out that chance for Indiana. And Mel simply overruns the ball as Lansade lets it go through.
Venetius Lansade, the freshman from Fairfield, Connecticut, part of the NYFC Academy. Bergman. Drop here to William James Hervé off the crossbar. I think Muse got his paw on it, and it doesn't take much. Maryland almost able to slide one in here.
This is great work from Matt Selevich as he leaves the ball, and Hervé forces Muse into a stressful situation at best.
William James Hervé, the freshman from Paris, France. Plays with a lot of flair, three corners for Indiana, now second for Maryland. Marcinich driven in. Muse will punch it high in the air, still in the 18. St. Martin, who's so good in the air, comes forward, and Glass will clear it. Now you're seeing the wind play a little bit of role as that one just deadened, and one back by Maryland. Lansade, a nutmeg there on Gutman. Lansade dancing. He'll square it to Sadich. Sadich will get it back. It takes a shot, but perhaps in reference to Chris Doran talking about being unselfish, could have taken a shot a little earlier. He went right into two white jerseys. Hard tackle from behind. Referee will play advantage Hoosiers. So it'll stay with Indiana. And now Indiana will get a whistle anyway.
Well, we want Amar Sadich to be taking shots. In fact, you know statistically that when he's on the board with four or six, he's probably going to sink one. Nice give and go working with Matt Selevich, but oh, maybe an extra touch there. He is so smart with protecting the ball, Dean, and I think he gets into these situations where he has overanalyzed in his brain how many players he's got to beat with that shot to the point where he's not even willing to take the chance but only to protect possession. But he's a really great player. He's back at Maryland finishing up his econ degree and looking forward to what comes next.
Ben DeRosa, long throw in, won by Gutman. Nifty little flick to Glass. Glass and Gutman. That combination has been really effective here down the run. Here's Frankie Moore. Frankie Moore scored a stunner of a goal last year at the Big Ten tournament.
Wins in their face as Indiana comes down again. Gutman lays this off for Frankie Moore, who has time to go ahead and take a settling touch, but not really able to get much contact on that. Wanting to keep it low, of course, because that ball is going to fly when you get it up off the ground. Dane St. Clair unchallenged in that sequence, and he'll put it back in play.
Frankie Moore I had Andrew Gutman on the United Soccer Coaches podcast a month ago, and I asked him who's the toughest player he's faced. He said, you know what, I got to look at my own team. Like, you do not want to go against Frankie Moore in practice because the man doesn't like to lose in anything. And you know what, I love that answer because you see Frankie Moore and you wonder just even the way he runs out there, but the kid's a winner, plays such a big role for the Indiana Hoosiers.
You think about the mindset of a holding midfielder, it's just not a sexy position, but the job is so critical to the way a team can function. And so, more than just physical, I think it takes a mental sort of an ideal and very specific, unique mental temperament in order to be strong in that spot.
Matulevic. The game winner against Michigan State, Matulevic, who began the season as the starter. The plan was to have him up there with Elney, but similar to Spencer Glass, he just seems to find the game a little better. Sasha Sarosky coming off the bench, as you'll see William James Hervey, who had that good opportunity. He's going to leave it for Justin Gielen, the two sports superstar, big time basketball player, good enough where he has been told he can walk on to Maryland if he wants to. That's legit. Play pretty good basketball in Terp Country. St. Martin played center back. No Donovan Pines. If you're out there looking, hey, where's that 6'5", looks like 6'6" center back? He is out because of concussion protocol.
One of the things that I've noticed through the course of the Maryland season is that when these subs come in, they tend to really change the complexion of the game. And so what we'll see in a substitution pattern likely in the second half is that these subs will come in a lot sooner in the second 45. And they'll disrupt things.
Here's Gielen for Matulevic. Here's Thomas.
They'll disrupt things in that middle of the second half, and it'll make it really important for Indiana. Well, this is sort of, wow, you don't see that very often. DeRosa couldn't keep the ball handled. He was partially, there he is. He actually was fully in great stuff from our Big Ten Network crew. In full posture for the throw-in, and the ball slipped out.
Ben DeRosa has to get it back to Maryland, but there's Gielen fighting for it. It'll go off of Glass and be a throw-in for Gutman.
As Maryland subs come in, it'll be incumbent upon Indiana in the second half to make sure that they do not get overly disrupted by the new faces and the new energy coming off the Maryland bench.
Ahead of Moore. Swing and a miss. Matulevic. Buckmaster just mistimed it. Unfortunate, but cleared out of there anyway. Matt DeRosa, wearing number 27, feeding Matulevic, picked up by War, getting some valuable minutes here for Todd Yeagley.
Well, I didn't think this was a really smart idea from Sadich, but Reese Buckmaster misjudges that ball, and the opportunity for Matulevic there on the far side to make a quality service or even take a crack at goal. Lays it back for Elney, it looks like that was maybe Samuels.
It was Mayer with the clearance. Ian Black, number 22, getting some time here as you're seeing that bench get even deeper with Renix and Dorsey with the USA under 20s. Here's War.
Justin!
Pacho spinning right into Bergman. That's DJ Reeves, who's doing the work defensively. Backing all the way back, he's off the bench. Here's Gutman, creates his own space, driven in, loose. And Thomas can't get to it. Gutman just has that ability to create all kinds of havoc just by delivering in a great left-footed shot. Going the other way, trying to find Gielen, and Mayer tracks all the way back. Chris Storm with 2 minutes remaining, knowing that at one point it was 7-1 in favor of Indiana shots. If you're Sasha Sorosky dealing with the news that Donovan Pines was not cleared based on the protocol for concussions, if you can keep it at zeros against this Indiana team that hasn't lost a Big Ten game, you're probably okay.
Cohesion has not been a problem, at least adhering to the tactical plan defensively. Maryland has done a really nice job. In this sequence, Andrew Goodman with the ball to the outside, get it in the mixer, see what comes of it. And Corey Thomas not able to collect that ball on the rebound.
There's Goodman again, this time defensively. Quickly switches the point of attack. Poncho's had himself a good 45 here. He's been very active. Dangerous shots. Good corner kicks for Poncho. Tries to go through three red jerseys and can't. Looks like we are getting some precipitation now at Grant Park, Westfield, Indiana. I have jokingly called it over the years the eighth wonder of the world. It is simply just amazing. Field after field after field, and an indoor center with three full fields that'll blow your mind. Here's Thomas over to Goodman. Goodman, top of the 18. Poncho, good effort, Goodman. It'll fall to him. Why not? It's been that kind of year. He thought maybe he'd get a little more magic here with 25 seconds remaining.
A couple of chip balls and a quick effort from Andrew Goodman using his left foot, and a lot of players are looking at it and saying, well, why doesn't he take that ball across his body and go ahead and strike it with his right? But he has been dangerous with both. Does a nice job on that last effort.
Two-storied programs here in semifinal number one. At halftime, though, it's 0-0.
Oh, it was a good game. Indiana comes out on the front foot. Maryland does very well defensively. Tactically, they kept their shape in the back and they kept their lines tight. Dane St. Clair did a nice job of, you know, getting that ball in spots and getting to it, coming up off his line in several situations where he really had to make a play. Second half with the win, things change just a little bit. We'll see how both teams adjust in the second 45.
Indiana with nine shots, Maryland with three, 0-45. All right, so the table is set for the start of the second half. Maryland back out there in their red, black, and black. Indiana out there in their all white. Chris Doran, I'm Dean Linke, delighted to be with you for Semifinal Friday on the Big Ten Network. This is semifinal number one. As we just told you, Wisconsin and Michigan coming up right after this. And you can see the flag blowing like crazy. Extra layers, blankets are out. It is going to be tough conditions here for the end of this one. And looks like perhaps even tougher for Wisconsin and Michigan.
So Indiana's got the wind at their backs. And they're not a long ball team. They tend to build up with the ball on the ground, and they do a really nice job with that. But at times, a ball delivered freely to the midfield and beyond with the wind at the back means that the front runners have got to be on their toes and ready to collect and move at any given moment. But I really do expect to see Indiana do much of what they've done all season, and that is keep that ball on the turf and keep it moving quickly.
Buckmaster, Mel will step over it. As we showed you, Jack Mayer, your Big Ten Freshman of the Year. Hervé with one of the best opportunities. Hervé hit one that sailed over the crossbar. And of course, for Indiana, Goodman smoked the crossbar, rattled it. Matsilevich back to Hervé. Good start here for Maryland. Sadich.
Dean, contrasting Indiana dealing with the wind at their back, you've got Maryland going into a very strong breeze. And so what they'll look to do is keep that ball on the ground for the most part. Probably have to put a little more pace on delivery and certainly be sure that they're playing the shorter ball delivered in the air.
DJ Reeves, who came on, stays in. Matsilevich, who came on, also stays in for Sasha Sorosky, as does Lance Sade. Sadich, and here's Samuels. Matsilevich, flag is up. We're going to talk more about it when Wisconsin plays Michigan, as Matsilevich gives the thumbs up, but you think about Wisconsin, that RPI, I feel like you need to throw that away. They do have those two massive top 35 wins on the road at Maryland and Michigan State. And then also, you got to believe, the committee's looking at how teams are doing going into the tournament. 7-2-1 for Wisconsin, as you feel like they should join the party, win or lose, against Michigan. Big Ten looking to send five teams to the Big Dance. These two, Wisconsin, Michigan, of course, Damon Rensing, the Michigan State team, a team that had eyes on trying to get to that final game against Indiana to win the Big Ten tournament. So some tough results, but that'll be a tough out. Here's Poncho down near the corner flag. Sent in for Glass, who stays in. Here's Reeves, goes off of Frankie Moore. Stays in bounds. All the elements, rain earlier, snow now, wind. As you said, out in open farmland in Westfield, Indiana.
Each year as we come back to Westfield for this Big Ten tournament, you can see at the exit how the development, the commercial development, has continued to grow, because this is a facility that hosts a lot of tournaments, a lot of regular club training sessions and club league games and that sort of thing. So the economic boon of this facility to the area has been significant.
Here's Glass, right to St. Clair, Spencer Glass.
Good work by Poncho as he delivers way outside. Spencer Glass, we know, can whip in a terrific ball. He's got a couple of targets inside, takes that shot. Dane St. Clair, not just with the wind at his face, but also now the snow coming toward him.
Glenn Hallis pointed out, our producer, and he was right. Gutyard was open right at the top of the 18. Schwartz was open on the far post. Spencer Glass taking the shot. Poncho, there's always that balance, right? Taking a shot and making that extra pass. A lot of times the former is better, particularly with Mercedes, as you were talking about on the other side. Here's Lansade going at Buckmaster. Gutyard in support. DeRosa, a little move, pass Glass. Can't get it to Reeves before Timmy Mell steps in. Throw in. Matsilevich. Matt DeRosa. Brett St. Martin starting at center back, where he's more comfortable because of Donovan Pines not being able to go.
Yeah, and he's been terrific. As I said, because he doesn't have as much time, maybe the cohesion not there, but they have been tactically right on point with regards to how they manage themselves in the back for Maryland.
St. Martin will bring it all the way back to St. Clair. There's Johannes Bergman. Mel stepping in again. Poncho, good first half for number 12. Trying to get by Bergman. Schwartz in support. Gutman. Always eventually finds his way into your screen, right? Just throw it over there. Number 15 will end up on it.
Ben Fronten, Ben Fronten!
Pass from Gutman to Glass. Turnover, though. Matsilevich checking all the way back.
Probably should have waited for his teammates to gather in the attack.
Gutman gets it through. Buckmaster elects not to shoot it. that started to resemble the great goal that Buckmaster scored against Michigan.
Yeah, here's Gutman. He's already scouted out where his opportunities are, and a nice ball to Buckmaster, who now runs into traffic and the opportunity to get around DeRosa, but not enough space as the defense collapses and Dane St. Clair comes out and smothers that ball.
That's a perfect example. Remember in the first half we talked about Gutman creating havoc just by driving balls into the 18 with his left foot. That's another example where, hey, the open lane wasn't there, but if you can hit it hard enough, it'll get through, and it got through to Buckmaster. Palazzolo pushed from behind. Foul on St. Martin.
St. Martin doesn't have to foul Palazzolo there. The Indiana player going away, playing negatively. Arm up on the back is sufficient. Let him know you're there and don't let him turn.
Buckmaster has pushed forward on the right side.
Maddie left.
Moore finds Gutman.
Sadich
somehow able to knock it off of Pancho.
Good, strong player, RSL Academy experience, smart, soccer IQ real high. He's played with great players in his career here at Maryland, and we talked to him prior to the start of the regular season, actually, and, you know, you told him, this is your team now, right? You gotta put something on, you gotta put your mark on this season with you driving the ship, and he's, you know, certainly well aware of it, willing to take on that responsibility. But with the injuries and the illnesses that have hampered the lineup for Sasha Sarovsky, I think Amar Sadich has been challenged by having to find that continuity in the middle of who he's working with.
Glass got under it. St. Clair is there. Meanwhile, on the other side of the field, though, Indiana, 16-2, 9-0 at home, 7-2 away. They lost their first game of the season to Wake Forest, arguably the best team in the country, in overtime. And then the only other loss was against Kentucky in a game that Todd Yeagley kind of stood up and said, you know what, I pushed my team too hard going into that game. And by the way, Kentucky, top four team in the country, by the way. And also Indiana, as Sadich is on it, keep this down, back to Muse. Talk about a team with six players in double figures, two more players that have 8 points. Gutman's got 25. Glass has 14 as a sub. Renix and Schwartz with 12 points. Dorsey with 10. Buckmaster, the right back, with 10. Palazzolo, limited starter, he's got 8. And Austin Pancho has 8. So talk about a unit right here where anybody can step up on any given day. It's the Indiana Hoosiers.
I don't think it's a matter of Indiana lacking that one star, you know, a Will Bruin or an Eric Zavaleta. I think it's really more a matter of the way these teams have embraced the system that Indiana plays. And to a point that you made earlier in the first half, Dean, it's the experience playing within the system that enables them to really score by committee rather than rely on one or two guys to get the job done.
Bergman to Samuels. Samuels has never scored a goal for Maryland as he pushes forward. Gutman. Boy, if you're the Chicago Fire, aren't you just salivating at the prospect of him joining your program?
They brought a couple of left backs up, haven't they? They did that with Patrick Duty. And then when Duty left, Andrew Gutman came in as a freshman, stepped right into that left back role.
Turn.
And I'd say yes, you probably are salivating. As Gutman anticipates his role on defense, he knows that ball's going to Hervé, and he steps in nicely as our Big Ten crew catches that defensive work. You know, those are the kinds of plays that you don't see on the highlight reel at the end of the day, but that is just really smart defensive work from Gutman.
Go back.
Frankie Moore always looking for Gutman.
Go.
Here comes Matt DeRosa going the other way. Square to Sadich. Sadich as the Terps running through the snow here, drifting around in the wind. Here's Lansade. Good little move, Lansade, but right to Trey Muse, perfectly positioned.
Good buildup and a lot of real estate as Sadich works his way downfield and then is able to find Lance Sade, who forces Tim Mell to step up and apply pressure.
He did start, but since coming out in the first half has not returned. So we've got 32 minutes left here in regulation, still no score. Sadich now to Lance Sade. The freshman trying to find his fellow freshman, William James Hervé. Knocked away though by Indiana. Poncho going the other way. Poncho staying with it, making a run in support of his glass. Poncho will check it back. Gutjahr calling for it. They go right side to Swartz. Swartz, such a good passer to Gutjahr, deflected off of Samuels as that was Palazzolo cranking it up. And it'll be a corner kick Indiana.
I really like the way Austin Poncho takes the real estate, gets to the top of the 18, then he dishes this ball to Swartz, who leaves it for Palazzolo. And in taking that shot, you earn the opportunity for a corner kick. Not a bad sequence for the Hoosiers.
Indiana's now posted double-digit shot attempts in each of their 13 games. Lofted ball. St. Clair does a good job to get around Gutjahr.
St. Clair not challenged much. Gutjahr not going to get up past his extended arms to battle for that ball.
Hervey may have inadvertently swung an arm and hit Mel in the face as he goes down.
Hervé had a couple of goals against Northwestern, earned his Big Ten Offensive Player of the Week awards. And yeah, that trailing arm, it looks like is, oh no, it actually doesn't even look like it was an arm. Just the ball.
Just the ball.
Because it feels like an icy rock, Dean, that's why.
Yeah. There's Todd Yeagley. Phenomenal job leading his alma mater. 2012 national champion. So close to that ninth star a year ago. I specifically remember a breakaway with Renix and Toy. If they just release it early, you felt like Indiana was off to the races. Instead, Stanford with the winner to win three in a row. In today's era of all this parity, to win three in a row, it's just incredible.
Yeah, it certainly is.
Both Stanford and UCLA losing this weekend. Of course, the Pac-12 does not do a tournament. Glass putting some pressure on Ben DeRosa. Here's Ben DeRosa getting it back from St. Clair.
Of course, Maryland is looking into the wind, and so anything Indiana can do to pin them in.
Gutman making a run. Gutman still with it. How does he do it? Gutman, how does he do it? Andrew Gutman, Big Ten Defender of the Year, eliminating Maryland players, and it's 1-0 Indiana.
Dean, this is just incredible individual effort as he blows by one defender, a second defender, a third defender. He's got one more to beat and the goalkeeper too. He's a Mac Herman Trophy candidate, and you just saw what I believe can be the biggest vote in his favor for that end of the year Player of the Year award.
Give it to him. It's also a BTN standout presented by Auto Owners Insurance. He's a left back with 10 goals on the season, part of one of the best teams in the country, and he delivers the goods when his team needs it. But how about that opportunity right there? There may have been seven red jerseys when it was all done, including the goalkeeper. Count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 when the goalkeeper gets over there.
Just incredible work from Andrew Gutman. Individual effort. He has put the team on his back so many times with 6 game-winning goals this season. This could be number 7.
Andrew Gutman. Even Sasso Sarosky, when we talked to him on the call, we said, hey, if you were producing, who would you spotlight? Of course, we were talking about his team, and he said, well, it's the Andrew Gutman show. And sure enough, true words have not been spoken even by Sasso Sarosky. It has been the Andrew Gutman show all season long.
His response was prescient in terms of what just happened to his Maryland Terrapins. Now they're going to have to find an answer as we watch contact yet again from DeRosa, and it looks like
Chase Gasper's got into the game. 28.
Chase Gasper all over A.J. Palazzolo. And there's your man of the match so far.
Man of the match, man of the season. First question is, you know, I asked Todd Yeagley, Todd, should I feel bad about the fact I think he should win the Mac Herman Trophy? And he said, absolutely not. What he's done at left back, the way he can unbalance teams, his defensive work getting better every single game. And Andrew Gutman has made it 1-0. Chase Gasper has been bothered by injuries most of his senior campaign. The UCLA transfer is out there now with Maryland down a goal. Make no mistake, if you are on that Mac Herman hype, you go ahead and just cut that video right there. And you see that smile just to add on to it. And you send it to the committee. What a goal. 10 goals on the season. St. Martin will bring it back to St. Clair. James Gasper in. Palazzolo. Collision there from Samuels. Ben has been quiet so far in this one. Sadich has not. Sadich has been busy. Chase Gasper with Thomas on him. Gasper, good ball driven in, top of the 18. Sadich first time, tackled by Sadich. Back to DeRosa. Now Elney, who's back into the game. Elney and Gutman off of Elney, back to Indiana. And Andrew Gutman, the hero right now.
We're talking about Herman Trophy candidate when we're talking about Andrew Gutman. And on this far side, the sequence builds up. We want to see Sadich go ahead and shoot. But the DeRosa delivery and the Gutman 1v1 versus Elney results in a goal kick for Indiana. Andrew Gutman, as a Herman Trophy candidate, you know, you have to go back to 2004 when Danny O'Rourke won the Herman Trophy Award for Indiana. And O'Rourke, for the first time, joins as a full-time assistant the Indiana coaching staff this year. And Todd Yeagley said this was absolutely the best candidate to join our staff in this year with this group, in large part because you've got the kind of success that Daniel O'Rourke was accustomed to when he was an undergrad at Indiana. They went to the College Cup, won it in 03. They went again in 04. They won it again. Daniel O'Rourke in 04 wins the Player of the Year award. Here they are again, a chance to return to the College Cup final with a quality group in a second consecutive year situation. And they've got a genuine Herman Trophy candidate playing on the field.
They do, and a genuine number six, just like Danny O'Rourke. You just saw him in Frankie Moore. A big hire, right? Brian Mazenoff attached at the hip for so many years with Indiana, taking the job at Ohio State. And you think about how humble Todd Yeagley is. When we were telling him how great he's done, he immediately went over to Danny O'Rourke and Kevin Ropston and the administration and giving everybody else credit.
Yep.
Here is Gutman again. Good ball in. Trying to find Poncho as Gutman looking to add points with the assist almost on the head to Poncho. Indiana, perfect 7-0 when Gutman scores a goal, trying to make it 8-0. Move on to Sunday's championship game.
I think we have an inadvertent spike on top of the boot. Unfortunately, Corey Thomas, the recipient. I don't think this was intentional.
It was out of bounds, though, as Gaspard.
Gutman does it in a lot of different ways, and as he penetrates on the dribble, he scouts his targets and delivers a terrific ball as Poncho gets tied up with the Maryland defense. Can't finish the play. Good work by the senior left back. Can you imagine having a bunch of friends and sit down and say, hey, I got some great left back highlights I'd love to show you. How many people would say, yeah, I've got time for that, Dean?
Yeah, absolutely. I got all day, though, for Andrew Gutman. What a fantastic season he's had. And, you know, you talk about that family atmosphere at Indiana. It was a lot of time he sat down with Todd Yeagley, even sat down with the Godfather, and then talked to the Chicago Fire. Where is the best for my development? It was pretty much a guarantee that he was going pro after a phenomenal year last year. But after all things were considered, they decided this was where he needed to be. They're going to play a lot of big games. And Indiana, they're going to try to win three trophies this year. You listen to Todd Yeagley as part of all of those game recaps. Indiana does such an amazing job with that, by the way. They talk about three trophies. You know what three they are, too.
Yeah, they certainly do. They've already won one of them. And Andrew Gutman walked off the field, and he reminded his teammates, this is the first of three.
The Big Ten regular season, the Big Ten tournament, and, of course, that coveted ninth star, the national championship. This year in Santa Barbara. Sadich, plenty of time for Maryland to stop all that talk about three trophies for Indiana. Foul against Indiana, we'll come back to Maryland. See the eight stars representing the eight national championships on the hats, on the jackets, on the jersey. It has been a symbol of Indiana, and felt like they were already printing those nine stars, right? As like they were going to take down Stanford, but Cardinal knocking off Indiana last year in the championship game in Philadelphia. Bergman will drop it over to DeRosa. And Chase Gaspard now wearing number 28 in that left back position. Ben DeRosa slides over, stays over rather, on the right side. And Andrew Gutman, an easy pick for your State Farm State of Success. He has scored all three Indiana goals against Maryland, including that regular season thriller with 18 seconds remaining. State Farm State of Success and perhaps the best college soccer player in the nation.
Dean, that was the first time Indiana had beaten Maryland since 2004. And in the Big Ten tournament, Indiana's never beaten Maryland. The scoreline holds. It would be yet another bit of history set by this Indiana group.
Grand Park, Westfield, Indiana, just outside of Indianapolis, third consecutive year they've been the host. Third year, Chris Doran has been with me. Always great to be with you here on Semifinal Friday, Championship Weekend, Big Ten style on the Big Ten Network. Lance Sade Marcedic. DeRosa. Here's Gasper. Gets underneath it. Left it out of bounds. There's Gutman communicating as well. That back line.
Well, that was one of the things that the coaching staff challenged Gutman with. I mean, he can go to Chicago during the summer and work with his club team and determine what parts of his game technically, tactically have to be developed. But bottom line is the coaching staff pulled him in and said, this year you are going to have to focus on being a strong leader for this group. And so that's been the development in his game.
Sadic. DeRosa. Distance deflected. Go over, and I believe that went off of Indiana. It'll be a corner kick here for Maryland. Plenty of time, mountains of time for the Terps.
Yeah, a lot of time, but let's keep in mind that without good work by Tim Mell to step in and Frankie Moore tracking as well, without Donovan Pines, a big 6'5" target, this is going to be a challenge for Maryland, because restarts are a great way to get back into a game. They're going to have to find a different route to goal without him.
Third corner of the game for Maryland, four for Indiana. Sadich. Bergman likes it on his left. Lansade. Muse commanding that 6-yard box. He's got it.
Ball comes way outside on the deflection. Okay, second chance. And laid outside. Trey Muse, I beg your pardon, stepping out on the call.
There's Buckmaster.
Yeah, you go.
Yeah, go.
Palazzolo. Buckmaster with Gasper. Putting it back for a second. Heavy pressure here now from Trevor Swartz. Swartz, another one of those players that probably does not get enough credit for the job he's done. Big time assist man. As Indiana sending Rennings. Here comes Maryland, though, the other way, and they tie it just like that. We told you there was a mountain of time left, and DeRosa making the run from that right back position, left back for Indiana, right back for Maryland, and we're tied at one.
Well, this was a bit too easy for Maryland to go from a throw-in in their defensive third and a quick transition through the midfield. They find the gap with a touch from Paul Binn, and DeRosa's on the way. He's got one touch, and he's inside the 18 and takes that shot and finishes. You mentioned that he's real comfortable up top in the attack, and he shows it here this afternoon. Way too easy for Maryland. Great transition for the Terrapins, and Indiana's going to have to regroup.
Wow, what a play. Really, it's been his brother that has played such a key role on the attacking side, but Ben DeRosa, the right back, first goal of the season, getting into the action, saying basically, like I said, all right, Andrew Gutman, you can do it from the left side, that left back spot. Good throw in, switch the point of attack, and a quality finish.
Great awareness from Maryland to see the gap in the space that had opened up.
If you're Sasha Swarovski, you gotta be so proud of your team. Did not hang their heads at all as we were doing the Andrew Gutman celebration tour. It was Maryland on the other side with the equalizer.
It's not a great sight for a Terrapin soccer fan as your captain, Amar Sadic, holding his ankle at midfield. Sadic with delivery, and Torrey Thomas gets a little step in there too.
See Paul Binn kind of screaming for a card as well on Thomas. He saw what happened as Thomas came in and stepped on the foot there of Sadich. And you're right, Chris Dorn, you said it best. I mean, it's one thing to lose Donovan Pines, first team All Big Ten defender, but this is Sadich's team. I mean, he runs the show.
Contact from Thomas after the ball's delivered. Thomas in on the far foot. And Sadich goes down holding his right ankle. Sadich actually wanted to be able to sub back on the far side, but he'll come to the bench and wait to be summoned back on the field by our referee.
That'll be big for Sasso Sarosky. You see Scott Butte. Ben, little touch to Elney. Goopin with his 10th goal of the season. Ben DeRosa with the first goal of his career. On the other side for Maryland with the answer. Before that goal, I was getting ready to tell you that Indiana's unbeaten in Gutman's career when he scores a goal. Down 10, those numbers pop up, and there's DeRosa making that run after the long throw. And what a finish by number 25, and what a time to score your first career goal as a Terp.
Picked a great moment. Credit him with terrific awareness of where he can be of service on the far side to his teammates and making that gigantic overlapping run.
Good to see Sadich back in there too, Chris Dorn.
Yeah, for sure.
Well, and we just said collectively, 20 minutes is a mountain of time for this Maryland team who is so much experience in big games. That's what these programs are about. Big game central, right? Every game. We told you about that grueling schedule. So there's nothing Maryland hasn't seen that they can't face. Despite some adversity, here they are back in the semifinals. Keep in mind, Maryland, their first 3 years as members of the Big Ten, they won the tournament. This was after they had won a couple in a row in the ACC, so they had won five or six in a row postseason conference tournaments before last year.
Perennial powerhouse out of the East Coast, the Big Ten enjoying that level of competition that has been added to these Big Ten team schedules. To say nothing of the advocacy for college soccer that Sasso Sarosky brings to the table, and he does that for the body of college soccer. He doesn't do it just for the conference, but it is important.
More from Maryland. Out wide to Gasper. Knocked out of bounds by Mel. It'll be a corner kick for Maryland. And you start to look tactically at some of the changes. They've now moved Matt DeRosa to center back along with Bergman and kept Ben DeRosa out wide and brought Gasper back in to play that left back position. So both DeRosa stay out there. And good adjustments here by Sasso Sarosky. Lance Aide driven in and right in front. Muse went down. Got saved there. Behind him was Thomas. And lucky it's not 2-1 Maryland.
Terrific opportunity. Three defenders going down for Indiana. The goalkeeper included is Swartz.
Watch this. Yes. Well, Thomas hits it right back into Muse. And how lucky is Muse that it didn't bounce off of him and go into the goal? Gutyard to Gutman.
Dangerous corner kick. And that ball knocked in real quickly, and yeah, you're right. Thomas is there with his knees, has to keep it off the goal line. All sorts of things could have gone wrong in that sequence.
Away. Rough.
Bergman.
Time more.
think about what Sasho did, Paul Bend was not healthy against Penn State. Penn State was able to take command of that game. They went to Bend to get the winner. In this one, as soon as Gutman scored, Chase Gasper was off the bench and in. He made adjustments, moved people around, told Gasper to give me everything you can, and Maryland with the equalizer. Justin Gielen off the bench. Here's the goal scorer for Maryland, Ben DeRosa. There's Matt DeRosa, who has moved centrally. Matt DeRosa is the player that Sasho Sarosky said really helped kickstart Maryland down the stretch. It's Sade. Sade Martin. St. Martin stays in there, but Matt DeRosa playing centrally now. So I believe in there for Cronally. Not said Eli Cronally's name, so I think he's on the bench. Super impressed. Chris, you were on the call with how Indiana responded to that feistiness I talked about from Tim Lenihan's team, as Tim Lenihan actually had predicted penalty kick winner against Indiana, but Indiana responded right in overtime. Let's see how they respond now against Maryland, as they had that 1-0 lead and looked like they were having a good time out there.
Well, they were at home too. Certainly it was there was a short list of advantages for Indiana, Northwestern having played the day before against Ohio State. Matt Motterwell scoring a goal for the ages at Armstrong Stadium for Northwestern late to tie that one up. But yeah, it didn't take long for Indiana to settle it in OT.
Chase Gasper looking for Elney, as I mentioned. Gasper was the first call after Indiana had scored.
Chase Gasper with the cut on Poncho, times two, and a really dangerous ball as Elney looks to keep that ball in play. Poncho doing a lot of work defensively here in the last few minutes.
Moore off the bench now for Todd Yeagley. Chase Gasper has won a lot of games at UCLA for Jorge Salcedo, has won a lot of games at Maryland for Sasho Sarosky.
No turn, Matt.
Right left. Here's Sasho Sarosky coaching from the bench. Little turn. Poncho Gutman. They always know where Gutman is, and they always find him, and it's a corner kick in Indiana.
Good timing on the run. Look at that 15-yard sprint. Bergman's got to step in very quickly and settle things before Gutman's got a crack at goal.
Hey, Paul, you got both on the box.
How does he do it? Just the way he times those runs, knows when to pick up that extra gear, and here he is causing a corner kick. Corner kick Indiana off the shot from Gutman. Driven in, looking for Gutman. It's Elney there. Frankie Moore.
Thank you, sir.
Whistle called against Indiana. Mayer, center back, pulling on St. Martin.
Good sequence. Frankie Moore knows he's got to get that second ball back in. Jack Mayer with a little bit too much in the way of contact.
St. Martin is on it. Knocked out of bounds. Tonight, speaking of Indiana, the Indiana Hoosiers are back in action with the men's basketball squad. Romeo Langford take on Montana State. That's 8 p.m. tonight on BTN. Subs here for Maryland. Looks like three of them. Geelan, Sade, and Bin all coming off. Sasho Sarosky moving some pieces around here and has Maryland back in this one, trying to take out an Indiana team that has not lost a game in Big Ten play this year. 8-0 in the regular season, first time ever. And then the winner over Northwestern in the Big Ten tournament. Trying to find Matsulevich, Elney from distance, not on frame.
Good defensive work by Jack Mayer, but the second ball opportunity by Elney. We haven't seen much of that from Elney in the way of shots. And you'd mentioned he'd sort of struggled over the course of the season. He's had some setbacks in the way of injury and only that one goal to show for his campaign this year.
Hervé back to Matsulevich. Buckmaster sends it forward, one back by Sadich. Palazzolo, switch it to Glass. Thomas, middle of the park. Buckmaster again. Frankie Moore. And here is Gutman. Looking for options. You feel like the Hoosier faithful just a little bit stunned. As, make no mistake, after that Gutman goal, they were kind of pinging around, feeling pretty good. And then that throw in, switch the point of attack. And Mr. DeRosa, Ben DeRosa, with his first career goal, has changed the dynamic of this one. Matsulevich is in. Open far side, little touch. But right to Muse. And Maryland looking extremely dangerous here in the final minutes.
Well, this is really strange as Matsulevich gets a great ball and he's 1v1 versus a freshman defender. I know he's the defender or the freshman of the year in the conference, but why not hold this? Cut to your left and take the shot. He hands it off to Padilla, who's not able to do anything but get it right to Trey Muse's hands.
Right, Matsulevich was open, Chris Doran. I feel your emotion right there. In the 18, if he can just turn his hips, he could go near post or far post. Padilla really only had one choice, and Muse was there. Here's Bergman. Padilla, the future of the turf. Sasho Sarosky so high on number 19. Glass with the run. St. Clair will clean it up and we'll roll it out to Gasper. Hervé has simplified his game early on, Chris Dorn. If you remember, Hervé was all about a little flash and spice and trying to nutmeg players. He has changed that and been effective. Elney is there. Elney, look at Gutman clean it up.
That could have been a critical error there. But Gutman, as you say, with the second effort to keep Elney at bay.
Elney, side of his foot. Looking for Matsulevich, cleared again by Indiana. Sadich, great touch to Elney. Right back to Sadich, didn't see Swartz over there. Poncho looked like he was clipped from behind and now he'll get the whistle. It's been a good game for number 12.
Working hard on both sides of the ball as Elney tracks him down and then clips Poncho.
Brett St. Martin, good tackle. This is Gutman who started the attack looking for Poncho. Palazzolo, I guess somebody was offside for Indiana. Thank you. sure about that one.
This ball goes through, and Poncho's there. He's offside. Poncho comes back but doesn't touch the ball. Palazzolo goes through with possession. And the flag goes up.
Glass to Poncho. This time it's Swartz. He'll step back on it. Lofted ball, Palazzolo. St. Clair able to rip it away. Thinking about overtime, Maryland 2-2-3 in overtime this year. Indiana 3-1, their only overtime loss. First game of the season. Wake Forest, at Wake Forest. Frankie Moore down, and St. Clair leads to his left.
Better hands from St. Clair in the latter part of the first half, and then in the second half, he had one or two situations where I thought perhaps he could have kept that ball in the early going, but he's done a really nice job here in the second half in particular.
Poncho again, keeping possession. Ben DeRosa, the goal scorer for Maryland, will chase down Poncho. Couple step overs, back to the left foot, off to Rosa. Corner kick. Corner kick, Indiana. A little over 2 minutes remaining in regulation. Zeros at the half. Andrew Gutman with his 10th goal of the season made it 1-0. And Ben DeRosa, the sophomore, with his first career goal for the Terps, made it 1-1. Flick off of Sadie. St. Clair will punch it.
Wow. I think the call is contact with St. Clair. I'm not exactly sure if St. Clair initiated this contact or not. Corey Thomas has got an arm up. Oh, it's the push underneath. Timmy Mell with the push on his defender. Brett St. Martin suffers in the sandwich.
St. William James Hervey fouled Mayor of the State of Indiana. Maryland, talked about that brutal schedule, and then almost 50% of their games have gone to overtime this season. For Sasho Zaroski, 26 years, the top man for the Terps. Thirteenth time they've met, every single game, either a one-goal victory or a tie. And we're looking like 90 minutes not going to be enough here.
Not really a surprise. Tournament environment. The weather not entirely cooperative, although I think both teams have handled it very, very well. And two of the perennial top teams in the country.
A lot of overtime soccer on BTN. Why not a little more on semifinal Friday? Through 90 minutes, Gutman scores for Indiana. Ben DeRosa with the answer for Maryland, and we're tied at ones.
It was a really great performance from two individuals, in particular from Andrew Gutman on his goal scored. But, you know, when you take a look at how well Maryland adjusted in that sequence where they were able to convert a goal, I think credit to that Maryland team with their mentality of we're always in it is what benefits the Terrapins here this afternoon. They've got to feel inspired.
What an answer for Maryland. A spot in Sunday's championship game on the line. It's going to take overtime, maybe PKs, to find someone. Semifinal number one, two-story programs. Your fifth seed, Maryland Terrapins. Your number one seed, Indiana, going to overtime to decide this one as we take a look at our Dr. Pepper tournament look. Indiana and Maryland will go to overtime to get a spot in that championship game. Wisconsin and Michigan, semifinal number two.
Yeah, four terrific programs, programs we expected to see at this point in the season when we began the year back in August.
Both teams familiar with overtime to advance.
They absolutely are. You take a look at what happened last weekend in the quarterfinals when Northwestern was able to tie things up. Then Frankie Moore went to work minutes later as Spencer Glass finishes things up and gives Indiana the home win, the chance to appear in the semis this afternoon.
Maryland had to go on the road to East Lansing to take on the Spartans.
Yeah, they'd had a string of road trips, but Eric Matzilevich does a terrific job in East Lansing to finish things up for the Terrapins and punch their ticket to this afternoon's showdown with the Hoosiers.
So overtime to get here and overtime to advance to Championship Sunday. You know the deal. Sudden victory time. You score, you win if you can knock it in. If not, after these two 10-minute sudden victory periods, we'll go to PKs, Chris Torin.
Well, getting to that point, sometimes, look, I don't think either team wants to settle on PKs. They want to get the victory. They count it as a victory, and Todd Yeagley and the Indiana Hoosiers are able to do that. They'll continue their string of victories in Big Ten competition over the course of the 2018 season.
Take a look. It was 0-0 at the half, but two goals here in the second half.
Individual effort by Andrew Gutman. He puts the team on his back, doesn't he? And he goes right through the Maryland defense to finish to the far post. And the 1-0 score line does not stand long. Maryland does a terrific job on this throw-in. Yeah, it's a throw-in. Paul Binn with one touch. Another touch by Hervé. One touch by DeRosa. And then the finish. That's four touches. They started that throw-in back at their own 18. And with four touches, they get downfield and get level with the Hoosiers.
First career goal from Ben DeRosa. And Chris, I love that breakdown. And Gutman, that was one of the best goals you're ever going to see. I mean, he broke down eight players. But I got to say, Ben DeRosa with that touch and then the way he stepped into it, a clinical finish to tie it at one.
Yeah, Trey Muse is not an easy goalkeeper to beat, no matter what advantage you have in that situation. But, you know, Indiana defensively let themselves down. Maryland did a terrific job of identifying in their spacing where the opportunity was, and they quickly got to that space and got that goal.
Great pass from Hervé. So now Muse and St. Clair could figure big in this one. Keep in mind, Indiana, they have not lost in their last 72 games when they score first. They scored first. The last time they scored first and lost was 2-1 at Michigan back in 2013. Of course, this year, when they score first, they're 15-0. Maryland gonna try to change that. The winner will advance to face our next game, seen right here on BTN. Number 3 seed Michigan, your number 2 seed Wisconsin. Wisconsin with 5 overtime wins, 5 of them. 5 of them in Big Ten play for John Trask and the Badgers. What a story they are. 6 wins, most wins ever for Wisconsin in Big Ten play. And this after the law firm leaves, their goalkeeper leaves, Masbrook leaves, and they're right back with 6 wins.
Most ever in Wisconsin Big Ten history, those 6 wins. And, you know, I think John Trask has just found some magic with the Badger program and has, much like what Shock has done in Michigan, has really found traction with the culture they're trying to create.
Frankie Moore. There's John Trask. Connected to Indiana, played at Indiana, longtime assistant coach. He's so much fun. We talked about with him the great job Todd Yeagley did, and Todd Yeagley went in Big Ten Coach of the Year, and John Trask half serious with he thought he should have won Big Ten Coach of the Year, winning 6 games with that team. Here's Poncho down near the end line, taken away by Gasper.
You just keep in mind it. All in context, he's on the phone with you and I, and he knows that he can kind of
have some fun.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Exactly.
We were dying. A couple minutes in here to this first overtime.
Here we go.
Go, 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 go
Julian Sain running right at Goodman. See number 27, Matt DeRosa, who was pushed into the midfield, and then his brother scoring the goal. Gasper came on the minute that Goodman had scored, and these changes have been effective for the Maryland Terrapins. Johannes Bergman down for a moment.
It's been a long afternoon for these teams. On the right side of your screen there, holding the hamstring. And even before the ball's put back in play, the break for a stretch. Hopefully that's all it takes for Johannes Bergman, an important part of that central defense for Maryland.
Johannes Bergman, a big pickup a year ago by way of Germany.
Yeah, he played for the 18s and the 20s.
Yeah, he's an older junior. So Sarosky coming out. Of course, remember, if you go out in overtime, you cannot re-enter in that overtime. Sasho Sarosky. Remember, no Donovan Pines, so Pines and Bergman, your regular starting center backs. Andrew Samuels going to come back on.
Well, again, I think even with the changes, Dean, Maryland has been very disciplined to the tactical instruction that was provided to them in preparation for today's match against Indiana. They've stayed compact, they've stayed connected defensively. If they don't have the cohesion because they haven't had enough games together, that's one thing, but they're following through with the game plan, and they've done a really nice job of stifling Indiana in many ways.
Thomas. Glass looking quickly, finding Poncho. Out of bounds, though, back to Maryland as Samuels comes back in. So that probably is going to mean the versatile Matt DeRosa, brother of the goal scorer Ben, who's on it now, will probably slide back to center back along St. Martin. And we'll find out right now. Yeah, there he is. So Matt DeRosa started the game at left back, then went into that holding mid spot. Now he is your left center back. Hervey. Ben DeRosa quickly to Sadich. Elney drop back to Sadich. Sadich dancing with it. No whistle. Frankie Moore did enough. Not the easiest ball back to St. Clair.
Yeah, he does well to handle it though. A little sweeper keeper move.
Samuels and Cronally both on the bench during that tying goal, but Samuels right back in there. Here comes Gasper with Glass trying to close it down. Gasper deflected by Glass, and Jace Gasper has changed the complexion of this game for Maryland. He earns a corner kick.
Well, he had three assists versus Ohio State. He knows how to get involved in the play, and he knows what he can bring to the attack for Maryland. Does a really nice job of taking up real estate on that run, and forces Spencer Glass with a last moment touch and a corner kick for Maryland. We talked about how important restarts are. We were reminded of that when we talked to Sasho Sarofsky on the phone this week, and he's hoping that it pays off for Maryland in this opportunity.
Maryland gonna try to win it here on this corner. Sadich sent in, looking for Elney, looking for St. Martin. So good in the air, but a whistle against Maryland, so it wouldn't have mattered.
A little too much contact at that far post for our referee. Indiana gets to go the other way.
Indiana has been involved in a couple penalty kick shootouts with the Wisconsin Badgers the last couple years. Semifinals 2 years ago, finals last year. Their last overtime Big Ten loss not requiring PKs was against Ohio State back in 2015. I think Steve Shucker on stats. Great job as always.
And thanks to Ryan Kelly here at the Big Ten Network, too, who keeps us posted on everything throughout the course of the season.
Trey Muse, if you remember, Chris, did not figure on PKs as Coach Todd Yeagley made a switch for penalty kicks. I figure this year he will be in there.
Yeah, a tactical decision. And I do remember that, but what I don't remember is the follow-up conversation with Todd about that. And I think there was just a consensus amongst the staff that the opportunity was greater for a sub.
Gutman drives it in. Now Gutman will have another chance. Everything goes through number 15. Gutman lofted ball, but right to St. Clair.
Not a bad idea, but when you've got a disadvantage in the way of a size matchup inside the box, love the overlap, but Mandane St. Clair on extension has got quite the advantage over anything that Indiana can throw at the goal mouth at this point. A floating ball should be in St. Clair's hands every time.
Less than 3 minutes remaining here in this first overtime. Glass with pressure on Chase Gasper, not 100% healthy. Was hoping to not have to play, but as I told you earlier, the minute that Gutman scored, he was in the game for Sasso Sarosky. Here comes William James Hervé by way of Paris. Hervé, Ilney with the dummy, hoping Matzilevich was behind him. Swartz back to Gutman. Tough ball for Frankie Moore to handle. Indiana, perfect 9-0 in Big Ten play, 8-0 in the regular season, 9-0 with the win over Northwestern to get to this semifinal Friday.
Come on, Diddy, go!
Now Buckmaster. Buckmaster has Glass on the right side. He'll use him. Glass back to his left foot. Here by Sadich. Buckmaster again. Gutman. Lofted ball. Trying to find Thomas. Now St. Clair will take his time. Another player down, exhaustion, even in frigid weather with snow and wind. These players giving everything they've got and then some, Chris Doran.
Lance Sade is down. He looks like he's pulling his guards off, so he's done. Paul Bin is going to re-enter. He's been terrific. Throughout the course of the season, plays at a sprint, had a couple of important goals.
Game winner against Denver and Penn State. Denver then sat out a game, got back in there against Penn State for the overtime and hit the winner. He knows how to finish off games. Starting to feel like 100 minutes may not be enough here to find a winner. Chris, we talked about the storied history between these two programs over the years. So many not just national championships, but college cups. I mean, Maryland had that run in 2002, 3, and 4 where they were there while Indiana was winning a couple. Maryland finally got it done for Sasho in 2005 and then 3 years later. But I still had to do a double take looking at the fact that these teams have met 13 times and not one game has been decided by more than one goal. So we should not be surprised then that 100 minutes of action and we're still tied.
One of the key subs this afternoon for Maryland, Lance Sade, is out now too. And so the bench got just a bit shorter during that first overtime period for Maryland.
And Indiana going to try to finish it right here. Pancho will drop it over. Swartz is there and denied by the goal scorer, Ben DeRosa. Start here to the second overtime for Indiana. They had plans of ending it right there in the first 30 seconds. Mayer. Palazzolo forces Matt DeRosa.
Right out of the break, quick ball across by Moore. Pancho settles, does a nice job of keeping possession, finds Swartz on the outside, broken up by Ben DeRosa.
Great look by our BTN crew, and here's the deal. As Swartz took that shot, guess who was standing 10 yards behind him and open?
Right left.
The guy throwing it in right there, Andrew Gutman. Palazzolo. Good work by the Indiana bench to keep that ball from going over the bench. Here's Thomas.
Maryland's got the wind at their backs, but I have a feeling they're going to stay nice and compact defensively and just frustrate Indiana for 10 minutes in hopes of getting the kicks from the penalty spot.
Glass to Palazzolo. Right back to Glass. Pancho over to Buckmaster. Everybody forward here for the Hoosiers. Sent in. Good turn there by Pancho. Thomas loose. Now Gutman going to turn back on it. Go off of Ben DeRosa. Pancho. Gutman can fire it in there. Steady lofts it. Good ball. And it's Frankie Moore so close. How fitting would that be, the two roommates, as Gutman finds Frankie Moore.
Great sequence, ball served in, quick touch. And how about Dane St. Clair? Ball's got across the whole line. Doesn't matter if the goalkeeper's on the other side. Corey Thomas with his shot. Look at the angle on this one. Gutman has his shot blocked again by DeRosa. Pancho finds him. The second ball. Great work by Dane St. Clair. Great awareness with all those bodies in front of him to come up with that play.
Frankie Moore with a spectacular goal last year here at Grand Park in the Big Ten tournament. So close. He was turning for the celebration, but St. Clair there to deny. So now Maryland, their first offensive sequence here in the second overtime. First 3 minutes, it was all Indiana. Matt DeRosa, now the center back, Ben. Palazzolo. Pancho had that touch and Pancho on it now. A little push there from Gasper. Palazzolo and Elney comes all the way back. Back to Palazzolo. Now Gutman. Gutman, what a ball. Just Thomas can't get his feet settled though. Still love that pass because if Thomas's feet are set, he can crush it. Buckmaster over to Glass. And Paul Ben. Now under 6 minutes, Gutman back on it.
Dean, I don't think Maryland wants this to be a 6 minute track meet.
Swartz kept alive to Gutman. Gutman is in. Gutman sliding. He earns a corner kick. And this might be the first time I've actually seen Gutman tired all season long with his extra gear.
On his way to goal with no one to beat. This is terrific work on the chase by Matt DeRosa. To tie up Gutman and forfeit the corner kick.
Go, Goody! You hear the crowd saying, let's go, Goody. Andrew Gutman with Pancho coming over to take the corner kick. Indiana driven in off Elney, Hervé. Maryland surviving that corner kick. Elney with Frankie Moore. Elney's going to slip. Moore kept alive. No white jersey there. Elney just fell down, Chris Dorn. It'll be a corner kick, Indiana.
This is incredible. What a terrific ball served long. And on the run is Frankie Moore, who turns away from Elney, but Elney misses altogether.
So corner kick other side, Trevor Swartz, one of the leaders in the Big Ten, and Nashley with assists. Would love one here. St. Clair will punch it. Palazzolo, a bit of a bite, but not on frame. He was hoping to just get it back on top of the six, but it'll go out of bounds.
This ball is whipped in nicely, and Dane St. Clair extends himself. How about that? Palazzolo looking to get it back into the mixer, especially knowing the goalkeeper's out and off of his line.
Justin Gielen replacing number nine, Sebastian Elney.
Good work by Dane St. Clair. The Maryland defense under several threats here in this second overtime period, and they're keeping their feet.
So Gielen, the freshman, is going to come on for the senior Elney. Flick there from Matulevich. There's Gielen. Right back to another freshman, Hervé. Hervé. A shot! Oh, my. So close. I thought that one was going in just like that. These freshmen for Maryland, no fear. It's as if they don't know any better. It's as if they don't know Indiana hasn't lost a Big Ten game.
Watch the hop on this dribble. Hervé does a nice job of staying over the ball, keeping it low. Can't quite get his hips all the way around. Delivers a decent ball.
So 3 minutes, Gutman. Gonna ping it long, looking for Palazzolo. Pancho. Ben DeRosa getting there first. Now Gasper. DJ Reeves. A play for Bell. Frankie Moore. Flag is up on Palazzolo. He was hoping to time that run, but he left too early.
Again, as this portion of overtime starts to look a little more like a track meet, it does not favor Maryland. Indiana doing a nice job of really testing Maryland in their defensive third of the field.
Indiana, their last loss to a Big Ten foe was back on October 10th, 2015. Incredible, because keep in mind, if this one goes to PKs, it'll count as a tie. And it's been PKs that have been the demise of Indiana in this tournament the last 2 years, courtesy of the Badgers. Here's Thomas. Thomas can win it. Thomas denied there by the goal scorer again, Ben DeRosa, having himself an all-tournament type game.
Ben DeRosa's been phenomenal. He gets the job done on the attacking side of the field, and then spends the majority of the game getting it done defensively.
Thomas with the cross! Far post, Palazzolo was there, Swartz was in the middle, Glass was lurking, but it goes all the way through.
Frankie Moore, Corey Thomas goes outside. Big ball, dangerous ball, first touch at the near post. It slips through, can't be finished. Trevor Swartz, Corey Thomas, A.J. Palazzolo.
60 seconds remaining here in this second overtime. If we don't find a goal, we'll go to penalty kicks to see who will earn that first spot in Sunday's championship game, noon Eastern, right here on BTN. Thomas will turn. Marcedic gonna try to manage these final 30 seconds. Ben DeRosa popped into the 18. Samuels. Push there, 15 seconds remaining. See if Maryland can get it one more time into the mixer. Matt DeRosa, no. Indiana and Maryland. Every single game they play is tight, and it will take penalty kicks to determine who advances to Sunday's championship game.
Well, it was an exceptional and exciting second half, and then in particular a couple of opportunities for both teams here in the overtime period. Indiana came out on the front foot in the second overtime period. Maryland, again, defensively, such a great job, despite the changes in the lineup, such a great job of keeping Indiana at bay.
Coaching will come into play. You got to pick who's going to take them. Then it'll be the Trey Muse and Dane St. Clair show, the goalkeepers for Indiana and Maryland, respectively. We're going to step aside and come back for PKs between Indiana and Maryland. It's going to take penalty kicks here to punch the first ticket to Championship Sunday. Maryland, your fifth seed. Indiana, undefeated in Big Ten play, your number one seed. Indiana actually lost to Wisconsin last year in the Big Ten Tournament Championship game in penalty kicks. If you remember, Lomeli came on for Trey Muse for PKs.
Trevor Swartz with that shot goes wide. The big save.
Philip Schilling for Wisconsin. Mark Segbers with ice in his veins. Mark Segbers, part of the law firm for the Wisconsin Badgers, winning the Big Ten tournament title for John. Goalkeeper.
In goal for Indiana, number one, Trey Muse.
Here the PA announcer introducing Trey Muse. And there you go. Well done, Chris Dorn. Amar Sadich, perfect 4 for 4. We'll step up first. The captain for the Maryland Terrapins.
Up first for Maryland.
Amar Sadich, the senior from Louisville, part of the RSL Academy.
A lot of thinking here when you win the coin toss. Do you kick first? Do you defend first? Always like to have the opposing team chase me, so kicking first was always my preference.
They'll kick into the win. Sadich up first. And Sadich with a clean finish. Muse guessed correctly, but Sadich, too much speed, and Maryland 1 for 1.
And 5 for 5 on his career as a Maryland Terrapin. He's very, very calm over the ball, places it deep and way away from Trey Muse. I think Muse may have even got a paw on it. But that, you're right, Dean. The pace at which Sadich strikes that ball, demonstrating the confidence that a senior captain should have.
So much pressure on these goalkeepers. So it's captain for Maryland, now captain for Indiana. Frankie Moore steps back. A little flare for number 13. St. Clair trying to get big. Frankie Moore, stutter step, and he'll hammer it home. Frankie Moore, Mr. Clutch, and through one, we're tied at one.
Very little in the way of emotion, but he's got some poise there, and he understands what job has to get done. The stutter step throwing Dean St. Clair off just a bit when it comes to deciding which way he's going. Good stuff from Moore.
Yeah, it was almost like Moore played St. Clair more than the other way around. Here's Chase Gasper. He'll go left-footed. Gasper! Solid finish. And again, the veteran stepping up. Chase Gasper, the transfer from UCLA.
Good work from Gasper, hooking that ball.
For Indiana, number 19, Reese Buckmaster.
Reese Buckmaster, the senior for Indiana. Second team All Big Ten. He's from Auburn, Indiana. Canterbury High School. And Reese Buckmaster doesn't even look at St. Clair. And St. Clair with the first big save. St. Clair guessing correctly, denying Buckmaster, and Maryland up 2-1 through two.
Dean, generally you expect your goalkeeper to come up with one big save in a situation like this, and Dane St. Clair has now delivered with quite possibly only two shots more to face. Beg your pardon, it'll be three.
So now Maryland, and denied by Trey Muse as they go to Mike Heitzman, actually, off the bench, did not play at all. The junior from Clarksville, Maryland, and Trey Muse with the answer back.
As we said, you got to expect a big save at least one time, and Trey Muse delivers big time 6'4" frame, picked the right side, not enough pace on delivery.
What a great shot of the emotion right there. Here's Austin Poncho, who's been outstanding this game, and there is the stutter step, just like Frankie Moore. And Austin Poncho, the senior from St. Louis, brings it home.
Well, with the stutter step, he makes Big Dane St. Clair not only choose but fall. Watch how St. Clair goes, and then the strike.
Up for Maryland, number 21.
One of the best games I've seen out of number 12, Mr. Poncho. And through three, we're tied at two. Now it'll be Lansade for Maryland. And Lansade denied again by Trey Muse. Two in a row for the Big Ten Goalkeeper of the Year.
Well, again, I think this is a sequence. Oh, my goodness. How about Trey Muse? I didn't even catch it the first time. Muse went left, then right, then down.
Up next for Indiana, number 17.
Muse showing a little bit of moxie there.
Yeah, big time emotion. Indiana trying to win the double, and Gutjahr will slide it home. And now it's 3-2 Indiana through four. Maryland must score just to stay alive.
Great stuff from Gutjahr. Has not seen the ball go in the net off of his foot very often in his career. But a great finish.
Trey Muse, your Big Ten Goalkeeper of the Year. Here's Bergman, who left the game injured. Bergman slides it through to keep it alive. But Indiana, folks, can advance to the championship game if they can finish their next opportunity.
Corey Thomas, who's nursed some injuries over the course of the season. Up next.
He can smoke a ball. Indiana to advance, and Indiana will advance. Your regular season champions riding their seniors to Sunday's championship game.
Thomas does a really nice job here, almost looking nonchalant as he approaches the ball. Dane St. Clair down and getting both hands, it appears, on this ball, but it was just enough for Thomas and the Indiana Hoosiers to celebrate an opportunity to compete for a Big Ten tournament title to match their regular season title on Sunday afternoon.
These two teams get together, it's always tight, and it took PKs. Thomas with the answer. You cannot forget Trey Muse, the Big Ten Goalkeeper of the Year, with back-to-back saves after St. Clair had made a big save.